You know how in school we're usually just told which books and materials we need to study? So it's super clear what we're supposed to focus on and what we're supposed to learn to be able to pass the exam and do the work. And this is all well and good, until you decide to get a job as a software developer. And then suddenly you're out in the wild and you're basically expected to upskill in new technologies all the time, and there's really no clear roadmap about how to do that. I know at least for me this was difficult in the beginning because I really had to bump around and just figure out what the most effective and efficient way for me to learn was. So every time I had to learn a new language or framework, I often didn't know where to start or even if I was focusing on the right thing. And I probably wasted a lot of time in the process. So in this video, I'd like to share some of the ways that I've figured out to learn more effectively as a software developer, at least what's worked for me. Hi, if you're new here, my name is Lindsay, and I'm a senior software developer and DevOps engineer at a large global consultancy. I'm also a career changer from a non-technical background. I transitioned from graphic design into tech about 5 years ago. So here's what I've figured out over the years about learning more proactively as a software developer. So first, I'd like to talk about tutorials. I love tutorials. So I think that tutorials can be a great place to start when you want to dive into a new language or framework. And I like the structure they provide, similar to like what we had in school. But I found that they can also really differ in how effective they are for me, depending on the instructor and the instructor's teaching style. So here's an example. I recently took a really awesome Golang course, and I felt like I flew right through it. It was super fun, I really liked the teacher, I felt really motivated to do exercises on the side, and it felt like I was learning really fast. There were definitely some tough and new concepts in there, but the way the instructor explained them made them really accessible to me, so I felt like I breezed right through that course. And it was so fun that after that I decided to take another course that caught my eye on Golang concurrency, but this time it was with a different instructor. And then all of the fun was over. I was suddenly really struggling to follow this new course, and I often didn't know what the instructor actually wanted us to do in the exercises. And this was pretty weird because actually a lot of the same concepts I had just learned in the previous course were in this new course, but suddenly I was just really struggling to follow along. So I think the main takeaway here is that even if an instructor has a PhD in computer science like this one did, or they've been programming forever, this doesn't necessarily mean that they'll be good at communicating effectively or teaching in a way that fits to your or my personal learning style. So for me, it's been really important to get to know my own personal learning style so that when I run into a situation like that, where I'm really trying to follow a tutorial and I'm just not getting it, even if I'm rewatching the videos a bunch of times, then I go ahead and look for a different instructor that maybe fits my learning style a bit better. So a couple tips about when I'm looking for tutorials. I generally look for ones that have a lot of ratings and then also really high ratings, so basically the bestsellers. And I generally also take a look at the comments to see what the experiences of other students have been. And then it gives a bit of an idea of what the course is like and also maybe what the level of the course is like. And then secondly, I always look for tutorials that have a lot of exercises. So this way you can practice what you're learning, which is really important. And that brings us to our next point, which is practice. So you may have noticed that I just mentioned jumping from the beginner's Golang tutorial straight into another tutorial, and I probably should not have done that. And here's why. I had unwittingly, or wittingly, entered into the realm of what's called tutorial hell. And if you're not familiar with it, tutorial hell is when you are learning something new and you do endless tutorials rather than actually sitting down to build a project. I know for me the thought pattern is usually something like, well, if I just learn a little bit more, then when I finally start building that project, I'll be really good, right? Because the more you learn, the better you get, right? But unfortunately, it doesn't really work like that with software development. So the problem there is that as long as you're following the tutorial, you're only seeing the problems that the instructor is showing you. So there's a lot of structure there, and you're guided to learn what the course is presenting to you. And that's fine for getting started. So you may be following along the course, and you're able to understand the concepts and do the exercises. But it won't be until you actually sit down and start building something on your own that you'll be faced with some of the real-world problems that you would see on the job. So for example, with the Golang course, it went great, but then when I finally sat down to try to build a small app, I immediately encountered the problem that the data wasn't making it from the backend into the database like I expected it would. So I googled around and found out that MongoDB, the database, needed my current IP address to be whitelisted for it to be able to connect. Okay, cool, done. Next, the front-end input form wasn't accepting the data. Okay, so that's the next thing we try to figure out how to fix. So the point is that tutorials can be really great for starting out, but it's not until you really build something that you start to sharpen your troubleshooting and problem-solving skills. And those are the skills that will really help advance your career. So my advice would be to learn just enough from a tutorial to get started building something, and then familiarize yourself with the documentation so that you can reference it as you run into problems. And at that point, you're really working like a senior developer. And that brings us to our next point, which is about reading the documentation. So a big game changer for me was when I really started embracing the documentation of the language I was learning. So when I was first starting out, I used to go straight to YouTube to look for answers. So I would spend a bunch of time clicking through videos and trying to find explanations that made sense to me, or look for answers there. And this is a super inefficient way to work. So as soon as I got more comfortable with the documentation and defaulted to just going straight there when I needed to look up answers, I became way more efficient with my learning and as a developer. Plus, all the seniors around me were doing it, so I took a hint. Don't get me wrong here, I still use YouTube all the time for learning new things. There are tons of great free resources on there. I just find that when I'm troubleshooting a specific problem, I usually find the answer a lot faster in the docs. And of course, there's always our friends Stack Overflow and ChatGPT, which are a great source when we're troubleshooting problems. But I would also say that there's a good reason why a lot of the top answers on Stack Overflow actually point straight back to the documentation of the language. And as we know, ChatGPT can be really helpful and it can come up with some pretty great solutions, but it can also completely make stuff up. So it's really helpful to have the documentation on your side so that you have a reliable source of truth to go to. Okay, the next thing I want to talk about is explaining it out loud. So this is actually one of my favorite techniques when I'm learning something new. And it's a technique called the rubber duck technique. And if you've never heard of it before, it's basically you pretend that you have a little rubber ducky or some inanimate object on your table, and you try to out loud explain the concept that you're learning to them. So as if you were explaining it to another person. I don't have a rubber duck, so I usually talk to my plants. And since my plants really don't know much about software development, I'm forced to explain it as if I were explaining to a four-year-old. And this is super effective because chances are, if you can explain something so that a four-year-old would understand it, you probably understand the concept pretty well. And this technique also utilizes something called active recall, which is where you actively retrieve the information that you have just learned from your memory, and so that you can apply it to the problem that you're working on. And this will help your long-term memory of the topic as well. So I found that this really helps to synthesize the concepts I'm learning, and also helps point out where the holes in my knowledge are. So once you start explaining something out loud, usually questions will come and you'll figure out which questions you still need to answer. So this might look something like, okay, so the modules are generic, which means that we'll need to pass the variables in dynamically every time. But why are we making them generic in the first place? Oh, right, because we want the other teams to be able to reuse them. Got it. And if you're not really sure what question to start with, usually a good one is, what are we really trying to achieve here? And that question is really helpful because it can usually lead you to articulate the overall goal that you're trying to achieve. And finally, a great way to really solidify your understanding of new concepts is to teach others. So once you've spent all of the time explaining to your plant and done the hard work of formulating your ideas and understanding, you'll be ready to start presenting that information to other people. And that is a sign of seniority. Okay, before we wrap up, I just want to say that these are some of the ways that I've found have worked really effectively for me to become more efficient as a developer. And for you, it might be different. So I'm definitely curious if you're on this journey as well, what has helped you along the way? Let me know in the comments if you have some other tips, or if you feel like I missed something that could be really helpful. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.